Hi everybody, welcome back to English 112. This is for our class for Tuesday, the 14th of December, as we are nearing the ending of the semester and continuing on with poetry. But I just wanted to draw your attention to the notes below. If you'll remember, right before Halloween, I gave a presentation in the downtown Greenfield Lava Center about horror film entitled Ticket to Terror, Horror Film in the Age of Anxiety. And that was recorded and is now available if you are interested in viewing it. You can see that the link is below. It also gives you a good overview of what I talk about in my CMN 201 class about horror film. Also, spring semester, my English 221 class, Shakespeare, is now online. So if any of you are interested in an online class, that might be a class in which you might have some interest. It was previously an in-person class, but it's been moved to a asynchronous online, which is very similar to the way that this class is structured. We have a shift in our poetry. Thus far, we've been reading mostly British poets and pretty traditional poets. And I chose a poem that was outside of the chronology, because I've tried to keep to chronology, entitled American Poetry, to sort of illustrate the shift that is going to be happening. And this particular poem, it used to be included in your text. It no longer is, but you can see in the, or if you're using a most recent edition of the text, it no longer is. But you can see below, I've included a link to that. And I wanted to read you this particular poem. And it's fairly short, but I think it helps to illustrate some of the changes we'll be seeing soon. American Poetry by Lewis Simpson. 1963. Whatever it is, it must have a stomach that can digest rubber, coal, uranium, moons, poems. Like the shark, it contains a shoe. It must swim for miles through the desert, uttering cries that are almost human. And as we talked about, poetry tends to be very dense and oftentimes obscure, so you need to do multiple readings. Probably one of the biggest challenges in this poem is understanding the first line. Whatever it is, it must have. Because it is a pronoun, so it's taking the place of a noun. But we are not given which noun it is replacing. So in your papers, for instance, if I had circled something and said unclear pronoun reference, it what or this what? Or he what, or she what, be concrete. What I was saying is that within that particular sentence itself, the noun that was being replaced by the pronoun was not indicated. Probably you mentioned the noun in a previous sentence, but you want to make sure that ultimately it's clear within the actual sentence itself, not rely on sentences beforehand or afterwards. However, in this poem, we are given information about what it is if we look at the title, American Poetry. So, if we were to substitute the title for the word it, whatever American poetry is, it must have a stomach that can digest rubber, coal, uranium, moons, poems. So, think about the idea that a stomach should be able to digest this array of elements. Rubber, which is associated with American industry. Remember, there was actually a line in this in Lorraine Hansberry's A Raisin in the Sun when Walter was talking about running rubber plants. Coal, which is also associated with American industry, especially during this time, a dirty energy, actually, as we've come to know. Uranium. And if you think about, not only is that associated with American industry, it's also associated with the American political system and its war structure, because uranium is made for bombs. Moons. Now, think about the time period in which this poem was written, 1963, and the race to the moon. Again, very American. But also, moons are oftentimes associated with romantic elements that we usually associate with poetry. The "Shall I Compare Thee to a Summer's Day" kind of poetry. And it should be able to digest poems. In other words, anything and everything American poetry should be able to discuss. It's not like a Shakespearean sonnet where ultimately the topic should be things that are associated with loftiness, things that are important to the human condition, like life or death. It can discuss the ordinary, it can discuss the ugly, it can discuss the destructive. Like the shark, it contains a shoe. Think about how predatory a shark is. The idea that a shark would have a shoe, whether or not it's because the shark has actually consumed a human being, so there's a shoe, or also the folklore and the reality associated with sharks. They'll eat anything, including discarded garbage. Like the shark, it contains a shoe. It must swim, American poetry, that is. Our American poetry contains a shoe. It must swim for miles through the desert. And of course, it's impossible to swim in sand through the desert. That's a paradox, an oxymoron, if you will. But the idea that poetry should be able to break all kinds of conventions and rules, especially because the poetic tradition, as we've seen, already has a long history. I think of music as well, how contemporary musicians will oftentimes say they were influenced by some of the masters of the past. So it's useful, if you really want to understand that musician, to understand the individuals who basically impacted that musician. Though you can certainly enjoy the musician's work as an independent unit. And it's the same with poetry. But if you are aware of the history, then you'll be able to see how authors are basically taking the history and changing it for their own purposes. Must swim for miles through the desert. Again, think about how difficult that would be and frustrating. Uttering cries that are almost human. And here cries are in a very negative sense, almost bestial, monstrous, not like the peddler crying his wares that we saw in something like Mrs. Mallard's story, The Story of an Hour. So there's a very negative tone to this poem, that poetry can talk about anything, including pain and despair, perhaps because America is filled with pain and despair. And I would argue it's not just American poetry. I wanted to use this poem as indicative of the poems that we will be reading in the 20th century, the 1900s, as well as our contemporary time. So moving forward, the poem that's next, The Road Not Taken, doesn't necessarily meet the criteria of what American poetry was discussing, even though it was written by an American, Robert Frost, and also written in the 1900s, 1916. But I wanted to talk about this poem because, first of all, it's very well known, much like the Shakespearean sonnet, Shall I Compare Thee to a Summer's Day? It's also, more often than not, misread, just like the Shakespearean sonnet, Shall I Compare Thee to a Summer's Day? And thirdly, the textbook provides us with an explication of the poem afterwards, an analysis of how one could go about writing poetry. So you know you're not writing a paper on poetry, but your final exam will be based on poetry for the bulk of it. I will be giving you a selection of poems that we've read and discussed in class and ask you to select two and to write anything and everything that you can about that poem that seems to have some significance. And this example of an explication in the textbook is a nice example of how you could go about doing that. Certainly much more polished and developed than anything you would do in a final. It reads more like a paper when somebody has the time to generate ideas and to polish things, but still I wanted to use it as an example. So, The Road Not Taken, which if you're using our textbook, page 871, I've also included the link below. The Road Not Taken, 1916, Robert Frost. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair and having, perhaps, the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear, though as for that the passing there had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trod in black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a road, and I took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference. And the way that this poem is misread is that people usually cite this poem as a celebration of independence and basically taking the road less traveled. Note the title. It's about not the road that was taken, the road not taken. It's about what happens when we are presented with choice and whatever whatever option we choose, it's very human to reflect back on the option we didn't choose, even if we are content with the option that we chose. So there's a sense of somewhat regret and longing here. And I wanted to read to you the explication of this particular poem on page 872. You can see it's divided up into paragraphs, much like it would be if you were writing a formal academic paper. And certainly the paragraphs are very well developed and very polished. Again, if this were double spaced, it would probably be something like a 2 to 3 page paper. Again, I'm not expecting anything this developed or detailed in your final examination. But I thought this would give you a good idea of how one could respond to this poem. So this poem, The Road Not Taken, intrigues readers because it is at once so simple and so deeply resonant. Recalling a walk in the woods, the speaker describes how he came to a fork in the road, which forced him to choose one path over another. Though, quote, sorry, unquote, that he, quote, could not travel both, unquote, he made a choice after carefully weighing his two options. This essentially is what happens in the poem. There is no other action. However, the incident is charged with symbolic significance by the speaker's reflections on the necessity and consequences of his decision. The final stanza indicates that the choice concerns more than simply walking down a road. For the speaker says that choosing the, quote, less traveled, unquote, path has affected his entire life. That, quote, that has made all the difference, unquote. Frost draws on a familiar enough metaphor when he compares his life to a journey, but he's also calling attention to a less commonly noted problem. Despite our expectations, aspirations, appetites, hopes, and desires, we can't have it all. Making one choice precludes another. Is it impossible to determine what particular decision the speaker refers to? Perhaps he had to choose a college, a career, a spouse. Perhaps he was confronted with mutually exclusive ideas, beliefs, or values. There is no way to know because Frost wisely creates a symbolic choice and implicitly invites us to supply our own circumstances. The speaker's reflections about his choice are essential to an understanding of the poem as the poem itself. Indeed, they may be more central. He describes the road taken as, quote, having perhaps the better claim, slash, because it was grassy and wanted wear, unquote. He prefers the, quote, less traveled, unquote, path. This seems to be an expression of individualism, which would account for, quote, the difference, unquote, his choice made in his life. But Frost complicates matters by having the speaker also acknowledge that there was no significant difference between the two roads. One was, quote, just as fair, unquote, and the other was, quote, worn really about the same, unquote, and both that morning equally lay, slash, in leaves no step had trodden black, unquote. The speaker imagines that in the future, quote, ages and ages hence, unquote, he will recount his choice with a sigh that will satisfactorily explain the course of his life. But Frost seems to be having a little fun here by showing us how the speaker will embellish his past decision to make it appear more dramatic. What we hear is someone trying to convince himself that the choice he made significantly changed his life. When he recalls what happened in the, quote, yellow wood, unquote, a color that gives a glow to that irretrievable moment when his life seemed to be on the verge of a momentous change, he appears more concerned with the path he did not choose than with the one he took. Frost shrewdly titles the poem to suggest the speaker's sense of loss at not being able to, quote, travel both, unquote, roads. When the speaker's reflections about his choice are examined, the poem reveals his nostalgia instead of affirming his decision to travel a self-reliant path in life. The rhyme stanzas of The Road Not Taken follow a pattern established in the first 5 lines, A, B, A, A, B. This rhyme scheme reflects, perhaps, the speaker's efforts to shape his life into a pleasing and coherent form. The natural speech rhythms Frost uses allow him to integrate the rhymes unobtrusively, but there's a slight shift in lines 19 and 20 when the speaker asserts self-consciously that the, quote, less traveled, unquote, road, which we already know to be basically the same as the other road, made all the difference. Unlike all the other rhymes in the poem, quote, difference, unquote, does not rhyme precisely with, quote, hence, unquote. The emphasis that must be placed on, quote, difference, unquote, to make it rhyme perfectly with, quote, hence, unquote, may suggest that the speaker is trying just a little too hard to pattern his life on his earlier choice in the woods. Perhaps the best way to begin reading Frost's poetry is to accept the invitation he placed at the beginning of many volumes of his poems. The pasture means what it says, of course. It's about taking care of some farm chores, but it is also a means of saying one thing in terms of another. So notice how we have a good introduction, some body paragraphs, a conclusion. I wish the conclusion was a little bit longer because that's not three sentences long, and a paragraph should be three sentences long. Notice the introduction basically gives us a summary of what the poem is about. And then the person goes and analyzes the poem. You don't necessarily have to analyze the poem from a chronological perspective. They begin with the final stanza. And notice that they are using specific quotation from the poem in order to support their points, much like you would do with short story and drama. And that some of the quotes I indicated had slashes within them. A slash indicates a break in the line of poetry because, as you will see with the poem, poems have staggered lines. So a poem doesn't necessarily go to the ending of the page. So if you're quoting a couple of lines of poetry and you wanted to show where one line ended and where one began, you would use the slash to indicate that. And this talks about what I had suggested to you, how this poem is oftentimes misread. It's not about the choice made. It's about the choice not made. And that the choice is not detailed to us so that it can be very general so that we can insert perhaps our own choices and experiences, no matter how small or large they might be. That one choice precludes another, and it's very hard to go back. And it also tries to take an attempt to make a statement about rhyme. Remember, we had talked about scanning a poem. And certainly, you could talk about the elements of a poem, like rhyme and meter, just like you can talk about the elements of a sentence, like parts of speech. But you need to talk about how and why that's important. And what this author did was talking about the rhyme, A, B, A, A, B, that the rhyme scheme reflects, perhaps. Notice how they use that word to basically protect themselves in terms of an argument that could not be defended. The speaker's efforts to shape his life into a more pleasing and coherent form. And then the idea of why it is that difference and hence may not necessarily rhyme completely. Isn't that the only way to read this poem? There are lots of other ways to read this poem. Certainly in this essay where it talks about the color yellow, I always think of yellow as significant because of my experiences with New England and some of the imagery that you would find in the woods as leaves are turning. And basically, this is a change of seasons, and this is a change of direction when you're making a particular choice. That isn't necessarily how this particular author talked about yellow. They said that yellow was a color that gives a glow to that irretrievable moment when life seems to be on the verge of a momentous change. Both of these could be possibilities. There are lots of other associations with yellow. Yellow is oftentimes known for cowardice, for instance. So that might be something else that you could perhaps incorporate into a poem. But I thought this was a really good example of how you could go about reading The Road Not Taken and also address a poem that's very famous that is very misread. So do pay attention to that title. And that life is a journey is something that we've seen in other texts as well. So as I go on to our next poem, next to, of course, God, America, I by E.E. Cummings, an author that you might have heard of. Notice these are very canonical authors, those authors that are considered by scholars and critics worthy of academic study. And this particular poem, I think, begins to illustrate some of the experimentation that American poetry was talking about, that we are going to be breaking a lot of the conventions in terms of topic and writing style. E.E. Cummings is known for not using capitals, as you can see in the poem on page 718, but I've also provided the web link, and also breaking many of the grammatical structures of expectations of sentence structure. And this poem I'll read to you, next to, of course, God, America, I, 1926, E.E. Cummings, quote, next to, of course, God, America, I love you, land of the pilgrims and so forth. Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early, my country 'tis of centuries come and go, and are no more of it. We should worry in every language, even deaf and dumb. Thy sons acclaim your glorious name by gory, by jingo, by gee, by gosh, by gum. Why talk of beauty? What could be more Iphil than these heroic happy dead who rushed like lions to the roaring slaughter. They did not stop to think they died. Instead, then shall the voice of liberty be mute? Unquote. He spoke and drank rapidly a glass of water. And notice how the textbook gives you a little bit of information about this poem. This verbal debauch of chauvinistic cliches, notice the run-on phrases and lines, reveals that the speaker's relationship to God and country is not, as he claims, one of love. His public address suggests a hardy mindlessness that leads to roaring slaughter rather than to reverence or patriotism. Cummings allows the reader to see through the speaker's words to their dangerous emptiness. And this particular poem, if you think about the time period, and remember how we've talked about this before, how important time periods are. 1926, what you would expect if that poem is going to be about America, that it's going to be singing the praises of America. It's going to be very patriotic. And that is not what this poem is. So it upsets expectations. And it's important that the poem begins with a quote, and almost all of it is a quote. And then we've got a break. And the last piece of the poem is he spoke, period, and drank rapidly a glass of water. And the assumption is that last line is giving us the setting. If somebody is speaking and drinking a glass of water, they probably are giving a speech. So this is somebody who's giving a speech about America. And again, if we assume the kind of speech that we would expect, even in today's world, if you're talking about America in a political situation, you would expect it to be positive. Instead, what we get is negative. And I think that's important in terms of the lack of capitalization, because we usually capitalize something to give it distinction, honor, and respect. And the idea is that he's not giving distinction, honor, respect to anything that's usually capitalized. Things like America itself, or God, or even the pronoun I, ourselves. And he says, and you probably recognize some of the phrases, next to, of course, God, America, I love you, land of the pilgrims, oh, so forth. I mean, these are typical patriotic phrases and snippets of songs that we oftentimes associate with patriotism. And he's saying, yeah, 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 and all of that. So that undercuts that. Say, can you see the dawn's early? My country, 'tis of centuries come and go. What, no more of it. Why should we worry? In every language, even. Notice how deaf and dumb is run together so that we don't have the separation of the words. So they really stand out. And basically, he's saying that Americans, particularly soldiers, are deaf and dumb. Thy sons, this would be soldiers, because at the time women wouldn't be in the military, acclaim your glorious name by gory, by jingle, by G, by gosh, by gum. Notice all those G sounds all in a row, g-g-g-g-g. That's called alliteration when the beginnings of words sound the same. Also, it almost sounds like gunshots, and gun also starts with a G, g-g-g-g-g. And talking about your glorious name by gory, by jingo. Jingoism means when you are putting your own nation above others. So his suggestion is that that's what America does. G and gosh and gum, these are supposed to be the appropriate terms in 1926 for showing dismay. And I'm sure we all know more colorful four-letter words that we use today. And guess what? Would have been probably used in 1926, especially in the context of war and soldiers. And then we talk about what, why talk of beauty? What could be more beautiful? Notice that that word is basically divided up. So we've got beaut, and then we've got a dash, and it continues on, ifl. The only beautiful thing in this poem, and even that is taken apart in the poem with the word. Then these, and this is what he calls soldiers, heroic, happy, dead, who rush like lions to the roaring slaughter. And why does he say that they rush like lions to the roaring slaughter? They did not stop to think. They died instead. Notice there's no punctuation here. It's all run together. Certainly when you start taking pauses, it makes a lot more sense when you add your own punctuation when you are reading it. The idea is that soldiers are blindly following orders and they're not stopping to question their government. Then shall the voice of liberty be mute? And talking about basically this poem, his suggestion that the voice of liberty is not necessarily serving one's country. It's critiquing one's country. Think about how controversial this statement would be in our own time, let alone in 1926. And again, you don't have to at all agree with the poem. But this is E.E. Cummings' perspective on the United States and also his perspective on the military. So while this poem definitely is somewhat surprising, probably one of the poems that I think is most surprising is a poem entitled America by Allen Ginsberg. And that also is not in our textbook, but I have a web link for that. Allen Ginsberg was part of a group of poets in the 1950s out of Berkeley, California, who were known as beat poets. And basically, what they were doing is lots of experimentation with poetry. They were trying to break all kinds of conventions. So, as much as E.E. Cummings was breaking conventions, as they say, you ain't seen nothing yet until you get to Allen Ginsberg. And it's very defiant, it's very unconventional, it's very stream of consciousness. So it sounds like the thoughts that you would have in your head, which means that there is oftentimes no structure to them in the way there would be when we write. And oftentimes the connections between ideas seem very nebulous and unclear because they probably only make sense to us and some of the re ourselves when we're thinking something. And also some of the references might make sense only to ourselves when we're thinking something, which makes it somewhat difficult perhaps to understand his poetry. It's deliberately unclear and difficult. Saying America is deliberately unclear and difficult. And there are many topical references. And this, in some ways, reminds me of monologues for talk shows that can be very humorous at the time in which they're talking about the current event that's occurring. But these things become rather dated. Even a few weeks later, people's memories tend to begin working so that they, or not working, so that they aren't remembering these events. So many of these topical references are based on events that were happening in 1955 and 1956. And certainly you can look up the history of many of these events, but most of these events are his criticisms of many of the injustices that have occurred because of America. Now, I could try to read this poem for you, but I don't think I could do it justice in the way that Allen Ginsberg himself can do it justice. And luckily, because we are moving into more contemporary poetry, we can actually hear the poets themselves read their own poetry. In fact, you could, if you wanted to, listen to a recording of E.E. Cummings next to, of course, God, America, I. But I definitely wanted you to hear a recording of Allen Ginsberg himself reading America, a draft of America. He was reading it to a live audience. This is one of the reasons why I wanted you to hear this poem, because it gives a whole different sense when you're reading a poem in front of an audience, because you're playing off of the audience. Audience is playing off of you, almost like dramas. There's a performance sense to it if you ever go to a poetry reading. And I wanted you to hear the response of the audience and also hear the tone in which he reads the poem, which might be somewhat surprising. His tone is much more humorous than one might anticipate when they are reading the poem themselves. And because this is a draft, he made changes to some of the elements of the poem afterwards. So the written published version is slightly different. So if you are reading along to the poem, and also listening to the live reading, you'll see that there's some changes. However, I've given you both the website to the poem itself through the Poetry Foundation. You'll notice that the Poetry Foundation is something that I oftentimes cite for poetry. It's a great resource for finding poems. And also, I give you the link to Ginsberg's live reading. So instead of my reading it to you, listen to Ginsberg's live reading. This is a longer poem. So this will basically end class today. And then we will talk about the poem next class and put some closure onto our poetry section. So basically, today's attendance question is which poem, American Poetry, The Road Not Taken, next to, of course, God, America, I, or America, even though we haven't necessarily talked about America yet, do you think is the most relevant to our current time in society and why? So that will be due on Tuesday as we are. Is that correct? Yes. So, oh no, that will be due on Wednesday, because this is for our Tuesday class at 10 a.m. on our discussion forum. And then we have one last class on Thursday where we will put some closure onto poetry. So I hope you're doing well. I'm doing well. And I hope you enjoy listening to Allen Ginsberg read a draft of his poem, America. Take care. Bye-bye.